Have you ever wondered how pro breweries carbonate their beer in the tank? Today, we're going to show you so that you at home can use a carb stone to carbonate beer in less than 1 hour. Let's get started. So what will you need to carbonate beer like a pro in terms of equipment? Well, firstly, you're going to need a carb stone or a carbonation stone, which is basically a stainless steel tube, stainless steel piece of metal that's got really, really tiny perforations in it. So it kind of looks like a bit of rough-ish metal, rough in texture, but don't touch it because the oil of your skin can block up those tiny holes, so handle it with care. But that's essentially all it is. Basically a piece of metal with really, really tiny, like 1 micron sized holes, so that gas can get out and ideally liquids not coming back the other way around. You're also going to need a spunding valve, which sits at the top of the fermenter, and you can control that by closing it off, and that restricts the amount of pressure that can actually be released through the holes of the spunding valve, and you'll normally have a bit of liquid like ethanol or stellar sand or something like that, or phosphoric acid, sitting in that little water trap so that you can see the bubbles coming out of the spunding valve. Then lastly, you're gonna need obviously beer lines, beer tubes, gas tubes, that kind of thing, as well as a scale that you can sit your CO2 tank on to measure how much weight is being reduced from that tank as you carbonate your beer. Also, ideally, you're gonna want some kind of a flow control for the CO2 getting pumped into your beer. I don't actually have that, which makes things slightly trickier, but it's still possible to do it without it. It's just ideal if you can control how much CO2 is being forced into the beer at any given time. Ideal, not super necessary, but would recommend grabbing one if you're going to do it this way. Now, if we want to carbonate our beer with a carb stone, there's really two main ways we can do this. We could do the slow, easy, and slightly frugal or slightly lazy way, or we could do the fast and more commercial way. Now, the slow and easy way is pretty simple. You connect your gas to your carb stone inside the tank, then you set the pressure that is basically slightly above serving pressure. So if we're doing, say, a NEPA, we want to serve at 12 PSI. Maybe we're pumping it in at like 13 PSI or something like that. What you're basically looking out for is that your carb stone is gonna kind of have a resistance pressure, so the amount of PSI that needs to go into the carb stone before bubbles start coming out. And to test that, it's really simple. Basically, connect your carb stone to your gas, put it inside a bucket of water or something like that, and then just go up by 1 PSI at a time until bubbles start to come out of that carb stone. Now, if you're gonna do it that way, it basically means that you've got your resistance pressure, which, for example, in my carb stone's case is about 2 PSI, so that I know if I want a 13 PSI serving pressure, for example, I need to pump it in at 15 PSI to hit that 13. Make sense? So basically, if you want to do it the lazy way, you minus the resistance pressure, ramp it up to whatever you want the carbonation level to be based on the, your regulator up top, and then you just let it go on flowing in until you've done it for enough time that your beer is actually carbonated. Normally for me, it'll take like a day, about 24 hours or so using the carb stone, and the beer is fully carbonated and I've wasted no CO2 because I've got it set to the pressure that I want it to be carbonated to. And I'll normally have my spunding valve a few PSI higher than what I've got this pumping in at, so that I'm not having CO2 blowing out the top and I'm not wasting any CO2. Now, that's fine. That's the lazy and easy way to do carbing with a carbing stone. It's the way that most home brewers do it. But the way that professionals do it is that they're focusing on saturating the beer with carbon dioxide. And for that, things get a slightly more complicated, but once you understand the basics, it's simple. So let's move over there to discuss that. The three things you're going to keep in mind is temperature, pressure, and volume. So you can use a carbonation chart, like what's going to be showing up on screen right now, to determine how much volumes of carbonation you need for the particular beer style that you are working with. So for example, a lager, particularly say a light lager, is going to have far more carbonation than say a stout or a NEPA, for example. So hone in on what style of beer you're working with first, and then what carbonation level you want, because the higher that carbonation, the lighter that mouthfeel is gonna be. The lower the carbonation, the fuller and the thicker that mouthfeel is gonna be. So for a NEPA, in this case, I'm gonna be aiming for 2.4 volumes of carbonation per liter of beer that I'm working with. Apologies, this is gonna be in metrics today, but Odin's gonna throw up freedom units all over the screen to make it easy for the Americans in our audience. Now, again, using a slightly different chart, we can see how many grams of CO2 we need to introduce into our liquid per liter. So if we're aiming for 2.4 volumes of CO2, that means that we need about 4.7 grams per liter of beer to actually saturate the beer to reach the point of being 2.4 volumes of CO2 per liter. We're working with grams versus volumes here because the easiest way to actually understand how much CO2 has gone in is by weight, because we can put our CO2 tank on a scale and we're basically going to count down how much CO2 has been introduced into the beer by how much weight has reduced from the scale's measurements. Make sense? Before I forget, another key thing you want to keep in mind when you're calculating the volumes of CO2 for your beer style is what temperature your beer is in the tank. So you're going to have the temperature cross-section cutting over with the head pressure PSI versus how many volumes of CO2 you want to be pumping in. So where that intersection meets is telling you what the volumes of CO2 is, and once you know what the volumes are, then you can look at a different graph to tell you how many grams of actual weight of CO2 needs to be introduced to saturate the beer to that many volumes. Now, the last thing you're going to need to keep in mind is how much volume of beer you're actually working with. So in this particular case, I know that my NEPA was originally 45 liters of volume after the boiling step. But then I also diluted that with 5 liters of water inside of the boiler because my original gravity was too high and I wanted to bring it down. So that gives us 50 liters. But I know that I've got 3 liters of trub loss and dead space at the bottom of my boiler. So only 47 liters of beer actually made it over into the fermenter. Now at the end of that, I've also, and this is where record keeping is very important, obviously, if you want to carbonate beer this way. After that, I've also done several trub dumps because of the yeast cake, obviously, and also because of the massive amount of hop debris, because this was a pretty hop heavy NEPA and I needed to dump a lot of those hops out after cold crashing. And I know that I've dumped about 9 liters of trub. So that gives us 38 liters of beer actually in the tank that needs to be carbonated. So this is where the maths becomes quite easy. Just pop out a calculator and go, I want 4.7 grams per liter of CO2. I've got 38 liters of beer to work with, which gives us a grand total of 178.6 grams of CO2 that needs to saturate that beer to carbonate it to 2.4 volumes. Now, this is the way that you're gonna wanna set your station up if you're gonna carbonate this way. You're gonna need your CO2 tank connected to a regulator. That needs to be sitting on a scale, which is gonna come up in B-roll right now, and that's gonna count down how much weight you've actually added. Then you're connecting that to your carb stone. When you do connect it to the carb stone, make sure that you flush it out with a bit of ethanol or a bit of sterilizer, like Stella Sand, for example, so that you're not gonna introduce any bacteria or anything into your tank when you start pushing in that carbon dioxide. And also make sure that you flush your actual carbon dioxide inlet a little bit so that there's not any oxygen that you're gonna immediately pump into your fermenter. After you've done all of that, the first thing you're gonna wanna do is make sure that you blow off all of that trub or yeast or any sediment that's settled around the carb stone. And to do that, it's pretty easy. Just put it on full ball, smash CO2 into that thing so that you can actually just blow all that trub off and make sure that that carb stone is clear. So if I open up my tank right now, I open up my inlet on my gas, then I open up the carb stone, it's gonna immediately roll pretty aggressively. Whoops, wrong tube. There we go. It's going to immediately roll pretty aggressively onto that carb stone. I can hear the bubbling going on inside the tank. I'm going to leave it like that for a minute, just smashing in CO2 to get rid of all that trub off the carb stone. Then I'm going to close it up and actually get my setup working to start pumping in and saturating my beer with CO2. Now that everything's set up, it's time to weigh my CO2 tank. Sitting on the scales, it reads as 16.452 kilos. I know that I need to pump in 178.6 grams of CO2, so minus that off the weight of the tank gives us 16.2734. Let's just round that down to 16.273. When we hit that weight on the scale, I know that the saturation is complete and carbonation is finished. Lastly, I need to set my equilibrium pressure, and I can do that by my head pressure. And because I have a spunding valve attached to this, which is kind of necessary to carbonate this way, I know that based on the temperature of my beer being 3.1 degrees Celsius, which is about 37.5 degrees Fahrenheit, I need this for 2.4 volumes of CO2. Again, based on the chart that I mentioned earlier, I need this to be set at about 10.5 PSI. And because this is in bar, I need to convert it. So it's gonna be about 7.2 bars. So if I scroll this up to the point where we're sitting at about 7.2, which is about halfway between the 6 and the 8, that is gonna be the correct head pressure on the spunding valve. So as I start pumping in the CO2, it's gonna start releasing the CO2 up through here at the correct equilibrium pressure. Now, all that's left for us to do is open up the valve on the gas, open up the valve on the fermenter itself, and you will start to hear the bubbling going on in action. If I just hold it down there. I don't know if you're gonna hear that over the noise of the glycol chiller going off now, but now we're pumping in the CO2. All we need to do is keep tabs on the scales that we're working with as we see the weight count down. And when we've counted down 178 grams, carbonation is done. And now here we can see that the CO2 is being released at a controlled rate by the pressure release valve, by the spunding valve. And here we can see that we're sitting at 14 PSI, but that's not really 14 PSI because this particular gauge is actually out of sync, out of calibration. And I know for a fact that it sits about 3 to 4 PSI too high. So that sits us at around that 10 and a half that I'm aiming for. And there you have it. Our beer is now perfectly carbonated. And I did keep a stopwatch recording of that. That was a total of 47 minutes. So from flat beer to fully carbonated beer in 47 minutes, that is none too shabby. So that is how you use a carb stone properly to carbonate your beer like a pro. Biggest advantage for this is obviously time. You can do it force carbonation in a keg. You can do the keg rolling method because it's kind of producing a similar effect. But if you have a carb stone, this is how you can use it properly so that you can go from flat to this in less than an hour. Cheers, guys. We'll catch you next week.